Hey everyone, it's Mystery Girl with Missy, and I'm Missy. Welcome back. Guys, I am here with my admin and moderator, Sally, who recommended this area of Staunton, Virginia, as well as the hospital we're going to today. Little did we know that there would be more than one, so I needed some help, and Sally jumped right in and helped me with the research, so thank you so much, Sally. Guys, give her a huge round of applause. I have up my copyright disclaimer, and I also have up my content warning. I need to protect myself. The videos and photos are used for educational purposes, and the information could be traumatizing to some. So guys, slam that subscribe, slam that like, and let's move on.
Welcome, Mystery Crew. This mini-series is a research collaboration between Missy and Sally. At the suggestion from Sally, we are going to Virginia, to the Western State, Lunatic Asylum. If you haven't yet slammed that like button, go ahead and do it now to show your support for Missy and Sally. Are you ready to go to Virginia?
All right, Mystery Crew. We're in Staunton, Virginia now. West of the Blue Ridge Mountains, at the intersection of 11 and 250, on the southeast corner, stands a beautiful and luxurious Blackburn Inn and Conference Center that opened in 2018 at the address 301 Greensville Avenue in Staunton, Virginia. Now, for anybody who would like to go and stay in what was once a lunatic asylum, you now have the address. It was known for its beauty and tranquil interior as well as the exterior. 190 years before it opened its doors and 196 years from 2024 stood a facility that had a resort-style setting with terraced gardens, roof walks to provide mountain views, architectural details that were absolutely breathtaking. The only thing was this was not a luxury inn. This was Western State Lunatic Asylum. So, if you ever wanted to spend that night in an old lunatic asylum since 2018, you now can. Let's go back in time, though, to 1770. In 1770, the public hospital for individuals of those considered to be insane or disordered minds was established in Williamsburg, Virginia. This was the first public institution devoted to treating the mentally ill in the United States. It was named Eastern State Hospital. And to this day, it actually remains open and in operation. By 1825, there was a need for a second asylum to avoid all of the overcrowding. The Virginia Assembly approved the construction of one to serve the western portion of Virginia. It would be called Western State Lunatic Asylum. The facility for the Commonwealth of Virginia was a five-part structure. It was built in Greek Revival architectural style and designed by William Small, William D. Phillips, Nelson DeJarnette, and Dr. Joseph. The facility was a site near the town of Staunton in Augusta County, west of the Blue Ridge Mountains. It was purchased and the construction began. It opened its doors on the morning of July 24, 1828, to their very first patient, a 22-year-old Anderson Kendall of Orange County, Virginia. He was a schoolmaster who was admitted for hyperactivity, obsessive-compulsive disorder, hysteria, epilepsy, and mania that resulted in eccentric behavior and religious excitement. Mr. Kendall was admitted by his family and told that his stay would be for approximately 4 years. He was said to be a very hard study. A second patient was admitted that same afternoon from Goochland County, Virginia. I am so sorry if I pronounced that wrong. The first woman arrived the next day and was admitted for a religious excitement. It didn't take long for the asylum to start to fill up with patients, so the Court of Directors implemented on admission screening processing to limit the admission to patients that were a danger to society or those who were deranged. During this time, a visiting physician, Dr. William Boyce of Staunton, provided care for the patients. The resort-style asylum surrounded the patients with so much beauty. Some had jobs around the asylum, such as gardening. They provided entertainment, such as dances, games, and sometimes concerts. The medical staff at Western State Psychiatric Asylum, they believed that if you put in the effort to provide enlightened care to the mentally ill and a beautiful atmosphere, that it would aid in the healing of their patients. The first director of Western State Lunatic Asylum was 26-year-old Dr. Francis T. Stribling, who was appointed in 1836. He was one of the original 13 founders of the American Psychiatric Association. Dr. Stribling believed that the interests and the needs of the insane were the same as those of others, and through human relationships, it could help restore their mental stability. He also believed that insanity was a disease, that if it was treated early, that it would be curable. He used the moral medicine approach, early treatment, separating the violent patients from others, healthy nutritious foods, occupation, exercise, increase in self-esteem, and being their friend, although this was not always the practice followed. Dr. Stribling was a reformer who worked closely with Dorothea Dix from 1849 to 1874 in shared efforts to understand and treat mental health clients in a humane treatment facility. Do you remember the first patient I told you about back in 1828? It was 22-year-old Anderson Kendall, who was told, him and his family were told, that he would be there approximately for 4 years. Well, guys, he ended up being institutionalized for 23 years. Well, I guess I'm wrong there. It wasn't 23 years. It was 23 years, 10 months, and 20 days before he passed away on June 13th, 1852. From dementia-related marasmus. I hope that's the correct pronunciation, but otherwise known as malnutrition. He is buried at the original small cemetery east of Staunton on Route 250. This cemetery was started by Western State. Now, there's more than one cemetery for Western State, so in a later part of the series, we are going to get into the two cemeteries. In between 1861 and 1865, a short-lived name change had occurred to Western State Lunatic Asylum from 1865 to 1894. It went back to Western State Lunatic Asylum after that because the name was getting confused with Central Lunatic Asylum. In 1894, it was also, like I said, the same year of that big name change, and it would create a little confusion between the two hospitals, which Central Lunatic Asylum and Western State Lunatic Asylum, although had some coincidences, which we will get into in a later episode, they were very different, in a sad way from, you know, how I take it. I don't agree with their beliefs. So for me, that was very disturbing for the reasoning for building of that hospital. But we will get into that in a later episode. So make sure you hit that notification bell so you don't miss any part of this docuseries. And while you're doing that, don't forget to hit the like and subscribe. Hitting the like helps get my videos out into the algorithm. And it's so important to me, guys. Dr. Stribling served as the superintendent and resident physician at Western State Lunatic Asylum until his passing away in 1874. After the passing of Dr. Stribling, the hospital had 6 more superintendents over the next 31 years. By the early 1900s, the utopian model of care slowly vanished and was being replaced by overcrowding techniques such as ankle and wrist restraints, straitjackets, and then came the electroshock therapy and lobotomies. Patients were referred to as inmates at times, like they were prisoners. That kind of makes me sick. I mean, how do you call a patient an inmate? They're a human being. They're not in jail. Please, that upsets me so much that very frequently they were referred to as inmates. Sorry, guys, I'm going back to it. When a patient would receive letters from the outside, they would be screened by the superintendent, and he would decide whether the patient could have the letter or not, and whether the patient's parents could write back. The superintendent would tell family members if they could continue writing or not. Western State Hospital had definitely changed, and no one was ready for what was about to come in 1905 with a newly appointed superintendent. The 1800s brought a resort-style treatment facility to Staunton, Virginia, to help those with mental illness, with a superintendent with the belief that tranquility and moral medications would aid in their recovery. Next week, guys, you're about to find out how and who changed the way of treatment and made a beautiful place extremely dark.
Thank you for watching. Please remember to hit the notification bell so you don't miss Bark 2 next Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, and slam that like button. Docu-series credits. Research done by Mystery Sister Sally. Location suggestion: Mystery Sister Sally. Research and script: Mystery Girl with Missy. Video and voiceover: Mystery Girl with Missy. Thank you again, and we will see you next week.
Hey, Mystery Crew. Well, that's the end of this episode, but don't forget to tune in next Wednesday at 8 p.m. for the next part. We truly appreciate all of your support and for you being here for this series. I just want to tell you, remember, every day's a mystery.